Live from scenic Italy, in the shadow of the legendary Monza Formula One circuit comes a night of speed, spectacle, and skill as the world's best kickboxers line up on the grid for Glory 25 Milan. In the main event, expect a punishing clash of styles as Dutch Dynamo and Glory lightweight world champion Robin Pokerface Van Roosmalen goes head-to-head with Thai powerhouse Sitichai Sitsong Phenong. Sitichai carries the hopes of a nation as the first Thai fighter to ever challenge for a Glory title. The stakes are high, and Van Roosmalen will need to be at the top of his game to retain pole position as the division's number one and keep his crown. Then prepare for the return of one of kickboxing's all-time greats as Giorgio Petrosian squares off against rising star Josh Johnson. After an absence of almost 2 years following his shocking defeat to Andy Risty at Glory 12, the doctor is back on home soil, looking to reassert his dominance against fan favorite and exciting lightweight prospect, Chauncey, who will be keen to put a premature end to Petrosian's return. Plus, the welterweights get the green light for the Glory four-man contender tournament. Congolo, Brunhart, Gallo, and Gaji battle for the chance to challenge the formidable Nicky the Natural Holzkin in December. Four men enter the ring. Only one will emerge the contender. Gentlemen, start your engines. It's time for Glory.
Glory 25 Milan was host to one of the strongest lineups of the year, as not one, but two title fights took center stage. It also marked the long-awaited return of one of Glory's greatest fighters, Giorgio Petrosian. We get started in the lightweight division in the Superfight Series as 23-year-old Croatian Teo Mikalic took on undefeated 26-year-old Russian Anatoly Moiseev.
The bell and round one, they touch gloves. It is Teo Mikalic in the black gloves, and Anatoly Moiseev in the white gloves.
Mikalic already starting to work that left jab, and there's that right low kick.
And going to the body with the left hook is Mikalic, looking to even his Glory record at 1-1, taking that fight against Myrtle Grunhart via short notice. There was a left head kick, another body kick by Moiseev. He used the right head kick to knock out Max Beaumaert in his lone Glory appearance. Moiseev undefeated at 14-0 with four wins inside the distance. Mikalic at 9-4 with seven wins via form of knockout, and that spinning hook kick to the head by Moiseev just grazed the temple. But man, he is a flashy fighter.
He really is. And that left rib kick that he threw earlier, he did without even a switch. He does it so quickly.
Moiseev started training at the age of 12 with kickboxing coach Igor Popkov. He took him to the level of champion of Russia and then world champion. He had more than 200 amateur fights. While Mikalic started Taekwondo at 8, started kickboxing at 13, boxing at 14. He was 56-4 as an amateur. A great way to start this special edition of the Glory Super Fight Series. On a historic night for the SFS, featherweight championship bout coming up. Front kick to the face by Moiseev.
It's little things like that that'll win you a round.
A la Lyoto Machida, Anderson Silva.
That was a hard
peppering Mikalic.
Yeah, but that was a hard check by Mikalic.
Left hook to the body, left hook upstairs, and a wild right hand. Good counter right by Moiseev. Had him momentarily locked in a side headlock. Not allowed in kickboxing. Another great round. And Mikalic trying to pepper Moiseev, but not a lot behind those shots. And like you say, has to make it dirty, has to get on the inside like this, and has to find an opening.
Yeah. The problem is the defense of Moiseev is almost as good as his offense.
And Moiseev, definitely a player at 154 pounds, and it appears he's on his way to improving to 15-0 and 2-0 here inside the Glory ring, barring a Milan miracle from Mikalic. Great fight.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecard. Here are the scores. 29-27, 30-26 and 30-26. A unanimous decision for your winner, Anatoly Moiseev!
Still undefeated, Moiseev moves up to number 9 in the lightweight division. Later tonight, Robin van Roosmalen defends his lightweight belt against Thai sensation Sitichai Sitsongpinong. The super fight show continued with two successive second round TKOs. In the first, an all-Italy affair in the welterweight division as 22-2-1 Stefano Bruno took on 9-3 countryman Osam Radwan.
The bell goes. This is round one. Bruno in the white gloves. Radwan in the black gloves. Immediately, Radwan whips out that left kick. Parried by Bruno.
Another one of these matchups, Radwan the southpaw and Bruno the orthodox fighter.
Bruno putting the attack. There's a knee from Bruno, a couple of knees, and I expected that. After all, his hometown of Genoa, the name derives from the Latin word meaning knee.
Excellent.
There's a right hand by Bruno.
Bruno smart to come in. Oh, nice.
He tagged him, but it's ruled a slip by the referee, Tobias Gerald.
That straight right hand of Bruno will be the effective weapon to get things going.
Oh, oh nice. And a counter left hook.
What?
And that clocked Bruno, but again, not ruled a knockdown.
Interesting. Wow. I probably would have called that a knockdown. It was
two near knockdowns in the opening minute
right.
of this fight.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's a right kick to the body by Bruno. And comes in. Oh, and there a delayed knockdown as the knee buckled. The knee touches the ground, and Radwan goes down. First time officially in the fight.
Time release knockdown.
Three knockdowns in a round or four in the fight constitutes a TKO. Bruno will be looking for the stoppage. As Radwan on the ropes, literally and figuratively. But again, Radwan has shown incredible resilience throughout his career. And again, he goes down to one knee. He would still touch the canvas. That's a knockdown.
Yeah, the referee
missed that. Oh, no, the referee missed that, man.
I know.
Brutal. Are you kidding me?
Bruno doing everything right, but now he's got hit with a tail end punch there by Radwan. Nice knee by Bruno.
Radwan bouncing back with a 1-2 from the southpaw position, and he won the lottery there as the referee missed the second knockdown.
Bruno's got to relax here, pick his shots.
Push kick by Bruno in the corner. And measuring him up for the knee, and that pops it back. And that's the third knockdown, but the second officially. The fight should be over.
The fight is over.
Ladies and gentlemen, this bout comes to an end by way of the Glory Maximum knockdown rule with an official time of 2:37 of the second round. Ruled a technical knockout for your winner, Stefano Bruno!
That was followed by a short-lived middleweight bout between Italy's Vittorio Yermano making his Glory debut at 27-5. Taking on Morocco's Samir Boukidou with an overall record of 34-2-1.
Second round underway here in the Palaipur in Monza, Italy. Boukidou in the black gloves, Yermano in the white.
Because Boukidou gets things done so many times so early, it must be nice to get into the second round and get some work in.
Gets a lot of high quality work at Hemmer's Gym, home of the likes of Errol Zimmerman, who returns from injury. Good to see in December in Amsterdam, Philippe Verlinden, Jamal Ben Sadiq, Marat Grigorian. Man, nothing but top quality sparring partners in that gym.
Now, Yermano's starting to get busy, but Samir Boukidou defends well.
Technique, okay?
Yermano favors kicks and punches from range, but does like the jumping knees using the knee attack here and trying to employ the Thai plum, the double collar tie.
Stop. No more technique, okay? Fight! We're seeing Germano get more aggressive, and I think it's causing Bukadoos to get a little bit emotional.
Yeah, he describes himself as a volume puncher. Has to pump up the volume here in round two, and is doing so. Much better round for Germano.
Yeah. He's doing the right thing.
Minute and a half remaining in the second stanza.
Bukadoos starting to get a little wild with his punches. Not a good sign.
Germano with the advantage in both punches landed, and he's thrown more, but neither has a big connect percentage.
Exactly. This is almost like a sparring session in a way.
Oh, good couple of right hands from Bukadoos.
It was a nice little shot at the end. It was more of an arm punch than a full velocity punch.
Minute left in the round. Blood around the left eye of Bukadoos.
Yeah, Bukadoos letting the Italian kind of back into this fight. I hope he wasn't overconfident coming in.
Looking to the corner for direction. Outside low kick to the lead leg.
I'm not sure.
Why would they touch gloves there?
I'm not sure on that.
Nowhere near the nether regions.
Usually that means, that wasn't very hard.
Well, that was a hard fall by both of them, and nasty cut.
This looks nasty.
And the referee calling for a doctor at ringside to check the wound of Samir Bukadoos. And the crowd here at the Pali Ipir with chants of Italia. And the fight is over due to a cut stoppage. Vittorio Germano wins his glory debut. Much to the delight of the partisan crowd here in Monza, Italia.
Our next bout features the light heavyweights. Number one ranked Daniel Ilunga with a 6-2 glory record and 58 overall wins took on number seven ranked Artem Bakhitov of Russia, who sported a 3-1 glory record.
This one promises to be a ballet of brutality as we are underway. And an immediate aggressive start by both guys as they tag each other early.
Yeah, but it looks like Bakhitov has got a little bit more steam on his punches.
No feeling out process and none to be expected here in the fastest fight sport in the world, glory kickboxing. 3 3-minute rounds, stand up and fight. That's exactly what Bakhitov and Ilunga have come here to do tonight.
Bakhitov throwing a lot of force between that straight right.
Push kick by Ilunga. Bakhitov, though, sitting down on his punches. There's a knee from Ilunga. Ilunga, the taller by 2 inches, wants to exploit every advantage possible.
Really picking your shots now. Ilunga up on his bicycle somewhat.
Bakhitov turned professional in 2009, signing with Glory in 2003 after he became a European super light heavyweight champion. I was going to say that maybe later tonight they could participate in a dueling piano session at a local bar as Ilunga plays keyboard for his church and Bakhitov, classically trained pianist, but they're not tickling the ivories here tonight.
No, they're not. Bakhitov starting to get low kicked on regularity from Ilunga.
Body kick by Bakhitov backs up Ilunga. Bakhitov quicker to the punch. Oh, left hook connects. A right uppercut, left hook. Bakhitov beginning to unload on Ilunga.
Ilunga's in big trouble right here.
And Ilunga staying in the fight, staying on his feet. Needs to circle away, desperately trying to do so. But Bakhitov all over him.
Wow.
An amazing opening round of action here between Bakhitov and Ilunga. Wow. Coming up on the final minute of what has been a fantastic fight, the penultimate fight on this special edition of the Glory Super Fight Series. Another right hand lands for Bakhitov, inside low kick.
And that Bakhitov right hand was a good counter off of a low kick.
Right hand behind the guard by Ilunga. Oh, ripping to the body with that right hand was Bakhitov. Counter right from Ilunga.
See, it's not so easy to knock another guy out when you're this highly skilled as both these top 10 fighters are.
Spinning back kick to the liver.
Good
by
shot.
Artem Vahitov with 30 seconds left.
I'm not going to be surprised if this is a split decision.
It's been vicious. It's been delicious. A tasty treat served up in the light heavyweight division, courtesy of Artem Vahitov and Daniel Ilunga. And they are going to the judges' scorecards. What a spirited scrap.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we again go to the judges' scorecard. Here are the totals. 29-28, 29-28, and 30-27, a unanimous decision for your winner, Artem Vahitov.
Vahitov's win moves him up four spots in the rankings to number three, while Ilunga drops down to number two. When we come back, it's time for the welterweights, with the winner facing current champ Nicky Holdskin at Glory 26 Amsterdam on December 4th. December 4th sees kickboxing back in its rightful home with Glory 26 Amsterdam. The Dutch Masters Verhoeven and Holdskin defend their titles for the very first time on home soil. In an epic rematch, Verhoeven takes on resurgent Romanian Benjamin Adegbui. Holdskin faces off against Glory 25 tournament winner Mertel, the Predator Grunhardt. Plus, the featherweights fly in the contender tournament. Glory 26 Amsterdam, December 4th, live from Rise Center. Glory 25 featured the welterweight contender tournament. In the first semifinal, number six-ranked Mertel Grunhardt of the Netherlands took on Italy's Nicola Gallo.
Time for round number two here in Monza, Italy. The first of our two semifinals in the welterweight contender tournament. Mertel Grunhardt in the white gloves, Nicola Gallo in the black.
It was a bit of a feel-out round in that first one. Grunhardt landed the better shots, of course, but he's not going for the gusto, and he's smart to not do that. He's not wasting a lot of energy either. Gallo has to know that he's got to mug Mertel Grunhardt to win this fight. He
Grunhardt
can't do
a heavy
at a distance.
Favorite in this fight, putting it on Nicola Gallo. Looking for the finish, Gallo shelling up in the corner. Knee to the midsection by Grunhardt.
Bad place to be against Mertel Grunhardt.
Grunhardt chasing a rematch with current champion Nicky Holdskin, still bitterly disputes the decision loss he suffered to the champion back in 2010. A proud new papa, his son Jafy, was born in February, so has a new mouth to feed and is fighting with a bigger sense of purpose, but again, against Nicola Gallo. This is expected as the time called by the referee.
Yeah, there's a nasty cut.
And another cut. Wow, right between the eyes.
Really bad place.
Oh. And the fight is over. And Nicola the Tractor Gallo, run over by the bulldozer known as Mertel the Predator Grunhardt, opens a nasty gash between the eyes, and the Predator has booked passage to the tournament final later tonight.
In impressive fashion, Mertel Grunhardt advances to the tournament final. Our second semifinal featured number four-ranked Johan Kongolo of Switzerland, with an overall record of 60-5, taking on number eight-ranked Karim Gaji of France, sporting an impressive 94-11-1 record of his own.
Fight! The bell in round one.
There's a low kick already by Johan.
Kongolo in the white gloves, Gaji in the black. And Kongolo representing Mike's gym, and should he advance to the final against Mertel Grunhardt, Mike Passanier will remove himself from the fight. He's cornering Kongolo now, but if both of his fighters make it, he'll just sit back and, I guess, enjoy the festivities. But Gaji might have something to say about that.
Gaji switching stances, coming in with that left knee.
Oh. Right hand connected, and Valenti, who is an embattled referee, to say the least. And the fans here in Italy whistling, which is tantamount to booing. And, man, there's a guy who needs to be admonished. And I'm talking about referee Valenti, who has not had a good night in Monza, Italy. Nice combination, culminating with a left hook to the liver by Gaggi. And Congolo trying to rough him up.
Yeah, he returns his own left hook to the liver. Congolo got chopped there by a right hook.
Under a minute left in the fight. Someone has an opportunity to make a statement, close the show, en route to the final where they will face Myrtle the Predator Gronhardt.
The judges are going to have to make a decision here because...
Oh, God, if, let's hope not.
If Congolo wins this round, it, on paper, it would be like a draw. He got a 10-8 round in the first round for Gaethje. Congolo winning the second, in my opinion. And if Congolo wins the third, then they've got to make a coin toss decision.
Yeah, those of you who watch the Super Fight series know what I'm talking about when I wish that the judges will not be a factor in this fight. 15 seconds left in the third round of this semifinal matchup. Jumping knee by Congolo. Just a horrible decision. Gabriel Varga losing the featherweight title to Sergei Adamczuk. Meanwhile, this one goes the distance, and we will await to see who will face Gronhardt in the final for a shot at the Glory Welterweight Championship.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three tournament rounds, we turn it over to the judges' scorecard. Here are the totals. 29-27, 29-27, and 28-28. It is a majority decision for your winner. Now advancing to the tournament final, Kareem Gaggi!
So in a hotly contested affair, Kareem Gaggi faces semifinal one winner, Myrtle Gronhardt, with the winner earning a title shot at Nicky Holtzgen at Glory 24 Amsterdam on December 4th. December 4th sees kickboxing back in its rightful home with Glory 26 Amsterdam. The Dutch Masters Verhoeven and Holtzgen defend their titles for the very first time on home soil. In an epic rematch, Verhoeven takes on resurgent Romanian Benjamin Adegbuyi. Holtzgen faces off against Glory 25 tournament winner Myrtle the Predator Gronhardt. Plus, the featherweights fly in the contender tournament. Glory 26 Amsterdam, December 4th, live from Rise Center. Our welterweight tournament final featured number 6-ranked Myrtle Gronhardt, who defeated Nicola Gallo with a second-round TKO. He took on number 8-ranked Kareem Gaggi, who won a close contest by majority decision over number 4-ranked Yoan Congolo.
Midpoint of round one.
I don't see any recklessness of Myrtle, and Myrtle has been reckless in the past.
Dropping right hand, another right hand rocks Gaggi, a flurry of punches, and down goes. And in the final of the tournament, three knockdowns in a round, four knockdowns in the fight, constitutes a TKO. Gaggi down for the first time in this fight here.
With a minute and change left,
Lots of time.
Gronhardt got to pick his shots here, though.
Gronhardt just unloading everything on Gaggi, has him in trouble along the ropes. The Predator stalking his prey.
Gronhardt. Gotta be careful not to use up too much gas here.
A knee, and that knee paid dividends against Gallo.
Yeah.
And it's, well, rattled the anatomy of Gaggi.
I love that knee. It's a stair climb knee. Come up with the right knee and then throw the left.
Man, just an unbelievable pace.
Mouthpiece.
The mouthpiece is out, and maybe soon Gaggi will be out. Kareem Gaggi. At 34 years of age, trying to, well, regain his faculties, but not getting an opportunity to breathe here as Gronhardt again on the attack. Gaggi swinging wildly, gets tagged with a right hand. A symphony of strikes from the Predator in the white gloves, Gaggi in the black.
Myrtle's starting to get a little wild here.
Yeah.
He's got to be careful.
Gaggi, known for his break dancing. He's involved in a different type of dance tonight, and not the kind I'm sure he would have liked going into this final. But you're right, Grunhardt, he's a big guy at 6'1", 170 pounds, and there are the total strikes. The numbers say it all. Under a minute left in the second round.
It's going to give Gaji a little bit of a shot here.
There's a beautiful left uppercut, right hand combination, outside low kick by Gaji, who's putting himself back into this fight.
Oh! Roundhouse into a crescent kick. I love it.
And we've seen it in the past. And no, not to be critical, but Grunhardt has faded down the stretch in the past.
Yes, he has. And it was like I was calling during the first round. I mean,
yeah, you're right. You
he didn't pick his shots.
He was all over Gaji, unable to finish him, and now
he seems to be paying the price.
He is paying the price, but still, with 15 seconds left in the second round, Gaji has definitely been able to get back into the fight. But Grunhardt still shooting. There's a knee, the right hand by Grunhardt. Terrific stuff here in the final. High drama here in round number three. Is Myrtle Grunhardt's gas tank developing a leak? Is Kareem Gaji got enough to come back? How do you have it after two rounds, Steven?
Well, I've still got Myrtle Grunhardt, regardless if it was a 10-8 or 10-7 round, ahead in the fight because of the knockdown. That last round was 10-9 for Kareem Gaji, but he needs more. He needs two more knockdowns minimum to win this fight.
And Gaji on the attack, delivering kicks that just missed. Now in the clinch, and the bigger Grunhardt should have the advantage, but in glory again, for those of you watching for the first time, if you clinch, you must execute an effective knee strike immediately, or the referee will break you up, and you only have 5 seconds to do so, usually.
Well, Grunhardt throwing some pretty decent punches here.
Oh, and there's that knee, his calling card. Yeah.
Gaji moving in.
And it looks like the crowd here in Monza, Italy, may be behind Gaji. Look at this stuff now. Swinging, good punches, unbelievable. Well, I guess it is believable because it's happening.
Right in front of us here in Milan, Italy. Grunhardt getting put onto the ropes again.
I've said it once, I will continue to say it, and yes, obviously, we are proud and honored to be sitting here ringside, but Steven, nothing beats Glory Kickboxing, the fastest fight sport and one of the most TV-friendly combat sports on the planet, and you are seeing evidence of it in every match here tonight.
There's no question about it. This fight is amazing. So much heart, so much courage. Kareem Gaji coming back from, looked like the depths of, he was gonna go out.
And this comes from two guys who have covered all combat sports at the highest level. And I'm very honored and proud to have been part of MMA and now boxing. But man, Glory Kickboxing, look at this stuff. Final seconds of the fight. Gaji and Grunhardt, maybe not enough for Gaji. But hats off to both of them.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three grueling tournament rounds, we go to the judges' scorecard. They score this bout 29-27, 29-27, and 30-27, all for your winner by unanimous decision. And now, Glory Welterweight Contender Tournament Champion, Myrtle Grunhardt!
With the victory, tournament winner Myrtle Grunhardt becomes the number one contender and will fight Nikki Holzgen for the welterweight championship on December 4th in Amsterdam. But up next, our first title fight took place for the first time in the Glory Superfight Series. Canada's Gabriel Varga made his first title defense since beating Mousab Amrani at Glory 20 Dubai. He faced number three ranked and undefeated in Glory, Ukraine's Sergei Adamchuk.
The bell in round one, the champion in the white gloves, the challenger in the black gloves.
And they meet in the center of the ring. Who will land first? And there's the low kick by Varga.
Varga told us that Adamchuk wasn't really on his radar until he joined Glory, and that win over Gregorian really put him on the map. He's been watching tapes on him, feels he's a good technical fighter, and someone who comes to fight, he feels it should be a great fight. We all concur.
It was interesting that Varga said he watches tapes. Some fighters don't like to watch tape.
I don't understand that. With all the technology at their disposal,
right,
today, get every edge you can, my friend.
I would agree with that.
Adam Chuk started kickboxing at the age of 7, has always been athletic, and if he prevails tonight, he dedicates the championship to his supportive parents, his mom, Ludmilla, and his dad, Sergey Sr. Varga with the advantage in total strikes landed. So still waiting to light that proverbial wick and set off the fistic fireworks here again. We know Varga very technical, Adam Chuk as well, but one of the thought processes coming into this fight was that, yeah, they would try to maybe amp it up a little sooner, and we're still waiting for that to happen.
Yeah, high risk, high reward, but you could go down in flames, too.
Beautiful right hand of the body by Adam Chuk. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, Adam Chuk trying to counter, but again, Varga comes in with a couple shots that land.
Right, fight.
Varga's lone loss of the Glory Ring was in the Glory Featherweight Tournament back at Glory 8 Tokyo in 2013, losing to the highly regarded Yuta Kubo in the semifinals. He allowed Kubo to dictate the pace and be the aggressor, and that cost him in that fight.
Yeah, that was a great fight. Kubo was the man back then. He slid since then. Maybe one day we'll see him here in Glory again.
Varga was in tough against Mosab Amrani in Dubai. Fight that he pulled out in the latter stages of that fight for the vacant featherweight title. Varga, the first champion, and oh wow, a clash of heads has opened up a cut.
I guess it's not in a bad position.
Coming up on the final minute of the third round. And a scrappy affair, not at all what I anticipated.
Well, we're seeing Adam Chuk become a counterpuncher, have his back on the ropes, basically return fire with a punch or occasionally with a knee.
And these clinches are, this is where, yeah, he's going to get warned, and rightfully so.
Yeah.
Keep up your head.
He's leading with it. I mean, that's what's messing up the face of Gabriel Varga. It's not the punches. And there, even there, he's employing a side headlock. I'm very surprised at what Adam Chuk is doing here in his title fight.
It's from frustration, though, because Varga is basically, you know, had basically been outpointing him in that first round, so he changed his tactic, turned it ugly.
Varga with the advantage when it comes to total strikes, throwing 155, landing 32%. Wise man once told me, fight professor, never have expectations, you'll never be disappointed.
Yeah, that's an interesting comment, because this fight is not living up to barn burner status expectation.
3 minutes left. Dare I say to save this fight. And again, it's hard, you know, far be it from me to criticize. These two are world-class athletes. It's just, like we said, Stephen, you know, you expect something. They both talk the talk. We know what they're capable of, and you're right. Sometimes the style, what is the cliche? Styles make fights, and this one, there's a literal clash. Although I've just read something on Twitter, even bad Glory fights are pretty good. Glory 25. Under 15 seconds now, the final 10 seconds of this championship affair. And we go the distance here in Monza, Italy.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 5 championship rounds, we go to the judges' scorecard. All 3 judges score about the same. 48-47 for your winner by unanimous decision. And new featherweight champion of the world,
So Sergey Adamchuk takes the belt away from Gabriel Varga in a fight many felt was much closer than the scores indicate. Up next, the long-awaited return of one of Glory's all-time greats as Giorgio Petrosian takes on upstart Josh Johnsey. It's been 2 years since Italy's Giorgio Petrosian entered the Glory ring. At 81-2-1 with a 5-1 Glory record, he faced Canada's Josh Johnsey, who at 23-5 and 4-1 in glory, had plans to spoil the hero's homecoming in this clash of lightweight contenders.
This is the fight everyone is talking about via social media. You can get in on the conversation at hashtag Glory25. In fact, the whole card is buzzworthy. Still to come, the main event for the lightweight championship. John C. had a chance at the title, losing to Sinichai Sitsong Pinong in the final of the contender tournament, but he is back. He demanded this fight. He was offered another opportunity. He says, no, I'll face Petrosian, and guess what? I'll face him in his backyard. John C. said that we might see some surprises. We've seen him improve throughout his tenure here in Glory, despite even the setback against Sinichai, where he ate repeated left round kicks. He went the distance after Sinichai destroyed the normally durable former champion David Kiria.
That's right. He's going to need surprises here tonight to get this win.
Oh, and there's the counter left hand.
Wow.
And the referee rules it a slip.
I guess.
He's in a bad minute left in the opening round. Petrosian on the attack. Johnson misses. Knee up the middle by Petrosian. He trips and stumbles. There's a left kick. So a good start for Giorgio the Dr. Petrosian. And Johnson trying to walk him down, trying to fake, trying to navigate his way to the inside.
Johnson's doing the right thing by trying to stay in his face, because you can't land a good shot if you're on the outside.
A nice slip in counter right hand by Johnson in the black gloves. Petrosian unleashing the kick in the white gloves. Petrosian checked that outside low kick.
Petrosian scooting forward behind that straight left hand into the left knee.
Johnson's been watching Petrosian since he was 14, looked up to one of the greats
total
of
strikes.
All time.
Yeah, look, 23-6, 50. Yeah, I'm telling you, man, Petrosian owned that first round.
There's a body kick by Johnson. A counter left just missed for Petrosian, has Johnson along the ropes. And Johnson again swinging, but hitting nothing but air.
Right.
And again, when you swing and you miss, you're expending a lot of energy.
That is a fact. One thing I noticed.
Nasty body kick by
Petrosian. Shot by Petrosian.
And Johnson give it to him. He takes it. He's fighting back.
That's what you have to do.
And the crowd chanting Giorgio. The doctor, known for his surgical precision, picking apart a game Josh Johnson inside low kick. Final seconds of another terrific round for Giorgio Petrosian. We'll see what this third and final round has in store for us.
So far, I have Petrosian winning the fight. 2-0.
Petrosian in the white gloves, Johnson in the black gloves. Johnson pivoting out of the way. Petrosian blocked that kick and then lands that crisp left cross and the left body kick, left inside low kick. You wonder when, he doesn't seem frustrated, but you have to wonder because he's throwing a lot, but look at the strikes landed.
Yeah, it's a complete whitewash. It's a landslide, especially in the knee department. 6-0 for Petrosian.
Again, very methodical, very composed, sporting that poker face. Speaking of that, Robin Poker Face Van Roosbalen getting set to defend the lightweight title. There's a stiff left hand that popped Johnson on the nose.
Yeah, Johnson's landing a few shots here and there, but not enough.
No, left head kick. And Petrosian just walking him down, taking his time. And it is about timing when it comes to the doctor.
And balance, too.
Absolutely.
Like right there when Johnson grabbed his leg, Petrosian regained his balance perfectly. Didn't even scoot back.
A learning, and you know that aspiring kickboxers, heck, even veteran kickboxers, taking notes, watching Giorgio the Dr. Petrosian in action as he batters him again to the body with a kick. Now blood around the right eye of Josh Johnson.
And the thing is about Petrosian, he's delivering an action-packed fight. It's not like a boring fight where I don't want to call Floyd Mayweather out on,
but Johnson's also making that. He's not
sure.
Up. He's gutsy.
Absolutely, but Petrosian isn't just moving away and dodging out of the way. He's firing back in the pocket.
And an aggressive Johnson with a minute left in round three. And Canada's produced some terrific kickboxers, including former welterweight champion Joseph Valtellini, a man many people believe should be the middleweight champion Simon Marcus, and a guy who, well, I'm just going to say it, was burned by the referee Gabriel Varga, who lost to Sergey Adamchuk on the Super Fight Series, as Jauncey still throwing but now forced to clinch with Giorgio Petrosian, who again, nearly 2 years after his last glory appearance, an ignominious defeat, the first knockout loss of his career to Andy Risty, has returned on a three-fight winning streak, and he looks like he hasn't lost a step.
No, he's right back in the groove of what he used to do. His timing is great. Once he gets his rhythm, boy, he's really hard to stop.
Nice defensive move there by Jauncey, who trips and falls. And hats off to Jauncey for going the distance for one of the best to ever put on the gloves.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecard. All three judges score them out the same, 30-27. A unanimous decision for your winner, Giorgio Petrosian.
An impressive victory by the Doctor moves him up to number three in the lightweight division, and now awaits the winner of Robin Van Roosmalen and Sitichai Sitsongpinong, who battle next. In one of the most highly anticipated bouts of the year, defending champion Robin Van Roosmalen took on Thai sensation Sitichai Sitsongpinong, winner of the lightweight contender tournament at Glory 20 Dubai, for the lightweight championship of the world.
You talk about styles making fights, we have two of the very best at the respective craft. Craft Dutch kickboxing in the form of Robin Van Roosmalen, the champion, and the Thai fighter Sitichai Sitsongpinong, who was a dominant Muay Thai fighter and actually was a slow starter in kickboxing because of his placid nature. He doesn't like to hurt people. He's a nice guy, but his camp told him, hey, you want to entertain, you want to make money, you have to go for the knockout. You have to develop a killer's instinct. We've seen that here in Glory.
Oh, we really have. Sitichai Sitsongpinong, so relaxed, waiting for his moment, already landed a few left roundhouse kicks.
You don't say. Van Roosmalen in the white gloves, Sitichai in the black, and he told us that would be his bread and butter. No real surprise or secret to his strategy. Yeah. He knows what got him to this dance. And Van Roosmalen, though, said, you know what? I may have some tricks up my sleeve. Of course, he's going to have to try to navigate and get around the kicking and especially the left round kick and get on the inside if he's to succeed.
Yeah, he's going to really have to get in his face and land that straight right like he just did.
And it is Sitichai dictating the terms of this fight here in round two.
Keeping it at range, at kicking range.
There's the teep for the push kick. Teep in Muay Thai. Van Roosmalen, the oldest of three brothers, his father, William Van Roosmalen, only man to knock out former heavyweight boxing champion Vitaly Klitschko in kickboxing. Van Roosmalen began training in kickboxing under his father at the age of four, but is also trained in boxing, wrestling, MMA, and even judo. He's a black belt in judo.
Mm-hmm.
But here he's trying to solve Sitichai and trying to get on the inside. It's simple. It really is. It's going to be either Sitichai at distance or Van Roosmalen pressuring him and getting him on the inside.
That's true. And Van Roosmalen right now is on the outside.
Nice right hand through the guard.
And being on the outside, he's getting outpointed.
Sure. Now they're inside, and there's that clinch. And Van Roosmalen looks have more muscles. More, like he looks a lot thicker, and I'm wondering if that may be to his detriment.
I think so, because Sitichai doesn't have the upper body development, yet he's much quicker, and he's landing more often. And Sitsongpinong.
Look at the numbers, though.
The kicks, right.
Yeah,
right.
With one punch, though. It's all kick. I mean, that's what it comes down to. The boxing of Van Roosmalen, the kicking of Sitichai. And now I know my ABCs. Won't you come and play with me? It's elementary, my dear fight professor.
This is truly a stylistic clash here. Van Roosmalen really looking to load up, really looking to do a Ramon Deckers on the guy, because Ramon did most of his damage with punches, and that's Robin Van Roosmalen in the image of the great Dutch fighters, Rob Common, Ramon Deckers, get things done with those big punches and some low kicks, but he doesn't want to try that against Song Pinong.
And there's the beautiful Alyssa, one of the Glory girls, along with Tia on hand, letting us know it's round four, the penultimate round. We're into the championship rounds here in Monza, Italy.
Now that left hook landed for Van Roosmalen. He needs more of that rather than a single shot here and there.
And again, he has to, the push kicks, the left round kick.
Song Pinong is doing his version. It's like a Thai version of Georgia Petrosian right now. He's very, very elusive, yet he can land at will.
Beautiful combination, but yeah, Petrosian looking to load up, or excuse me, you got me saying Petrosian. Van Roosmalen loading up with the left hook. And there's that right uppercut on the inside, battering away on the body of the Thai fighter. Outside low kick scored.
He's got to find the chin of Song Pinong, and that's something that nobody yet in Glory has been able to do. See, Song Pinong has got this little movement that he does. Watch. When he takes a step back, takes a step to the side, little tiny moves. He's never in the exact same place. It may seem like he is, but he's not.
Wow, nice combination through the guard. And if I were Sitich, I'd invest in ice. I know it's anybody can make it, but man, if it were a commodity, he'd be a rich, rich man because all his opponents require a lot of it after eating those kicks. A minute and a half left in the round four.
And ibuprofen.
So Van Roosmalen still trying to unload, misses with that right hand.
See,
and he gets in these points, these score. It's not like Sitich is not scoring on the counter, he's scoring.
Yeah, he counters back. Like I say, it's very Petrosian-esque for Sitich, what he's doing, because he's not loading up, not going for the knockout. He's just trying to win the fight because it is a kickboxing match. And they say that boxing, what's the definition? Hitting and not being hit?
Right.
Kickboxing, same thing, except for you have the kicks in the knees.
And we've seen Sitich trying to open up the body by the combination upstairs. There's another jumping knee in the clinch. 45 seconds remain in the fourth round. Robin Van Roosmalen, the lightweight champion, hoping to successfully defend the title for the second time. But Sitich hoping to bring the Glory Championship back to the Mecca of Muay Thai, Thailand. And of course, in Glory, no elbow strikes. No sustained clinching like you will see in Muay Thai, but Sitich doesn't want to clinch, period. He wants to keep it at distance. He's in his wheelhouse here, Stephen.
Yeah, there are Thai fighters who don't favor the clinch. I mean, you think that they all fight the same way? They don't.
No. But it is prominent as we head to the fifth and final round, the lightweight title. At stake.
Last round. Fight.
The fifth and final round underway. We expect a sense of urgency from Van Roosmalen. Sitich will be content to stay at distance and continue to do what he has done all night long.
Pretty
knee
much
up the middle.
Been one-way traffic the whole time for Sitich. He's so relaxed, too.
Unbelievably composed. And, oh, yeah, again, as we mentioned with Jauncey, facing the challenge of his life earlier tonight against one of his heroes, Giorgio Petrosian. He's 22. Well, Sitich is only 24 years of age. Van Roosmalen, just 26.
And Van Roosmalen definitely outscoring Sitich with punches, but how are the judges going to look at that?
And
because
I
look at control of the fight,
right,
to be honest.
And are they effective? I mean, well, it is damage, but is he doing damage?
I haven't seen him do any damage.
Because number one is the number of knockdowns. We haven't seen any of that. Number two in the Glory criteria is damage.
I actually question that stat.
I see damage on the arm.
I question that stat, actually. Because he must have hit him on the arm or something, because he hasn't really hit him clean on the chin or the body.
Hey, don't get my
Showtime
color commentator, Paulie Malignaggi.
What's up, Paulie? We will meet one day. You can show me how to slip a left hook.
He does not like the punch stats in boxing. I've had my
issues occasionally with them, too. But not because I want to be right every time I score a fight.
But to be fair, they are used as a barometer to give the audience an idea of what's going on. They're not perfect either.
I said, if you got punch stats, why do you need judges?
Yeah.
If they're accurate.
Right. Hey, statistics never lie, right?
And there's that left roundhouse kick in the straight left hand for Song Pinong.
Yep.
Again and again.
And, you know, when we talk about the defense of that left round kick, in Thailand, you have the high knee, the flexibility. They're able to lift the knee and block with the
bone. That's very risky, too. You have to
drop balance.
You can snow, but you can get swept if he throws
that's
a low
what I'm
kick.
Saying, absolutely.
You don't know what kind of kick he's going to throw.
No,
but these guys do know.
But he's not blocking it.
1 minute left for Van Roosmalen to have to do something big like it. I knock him, basically.
So, with 54 seconds left here in Monza, Italy, in the main event, will Robin Van Roosmalen be able to hold on to his Glory Lightweight Championship, or will history be made on this historic night? Will Sinichai Sitsong Phenom, the winner of the Lightweight Contender Tournament, in which he dominated and destroyed the former champion David Kyria before beating Josh Johnson in the final, will he become the first Thai Glory Champion? 25 seconds to go.
Looks like we are on the way to getting our own Buakaw, Moro.
Buakaw Banchamek, now used to be known as Buakaw Porpremek, was considered the best Thai fighter to make the transition to kickboxing. You're right. Following in his footsteps is Sinichai Sitsong Phenom. Van Roosmalen looking to unload, misses with the kicks, and we are headed to the judges' scorecards to determine the Glory Lightweight Championship.
Ladies and gentlemen, after five championship rounds, we go to the judges' scorecard. All three judges score the bout 48-47, a unanimous decision for your winner and still Glory Lightweight Champion of the World, Robin Van Roosmalen.
In what many are still calling a controversial decision, Robin Van Roosmalen defends his title for the second time. That will do it from Milan. Don't forget, our season-ending event takes place at Glory 26 Amsterdam on December 4th, as two more titles are at stake in both the heavyweight and welterweight divisions.